as I go back and read through stuff and look through stuff and listen to recordings and so forth and so on, it's amazing to me, just like Marley King down there. We had the deal on his yard. It was represented to me that that yard done over $2 million a year in retail sales. And then after the county got involved, it all changed. Well, then when I went out there to Caswell County, right across the Caswell County line, at the, I guess that may be the balance of watershed. It might be the critical watershed, I don't know. But I sold that yard, built it from scratch, sold it, and went back to Marley King three different times and said, will you still do the deal? No, I ain't gonna sell it, no, I ain't gonna sell it, no, I ain't gonna sell it. But now Copart's there. He's in the building, and y'all have a picture of the sign with the phone number on it, doing his brick and mortar from there, and now he's got cars right up the road over there. But hey, he's a slick millionaire, Rick, I would guess. People like me, government's supposed to help, but over and over and over, I see these things that's happening as far as crimes go. And they say, oh, look at his record. What did the government do to help them with their problems?
Okay. Any responses, Commissioner? All right, moving on. Approval of the agenda. I ask for a motion on that.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Thank you, Roger. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
On the consent agenda, is there anything on that that we need to pull out and discuss? Or
I move we approve the consent agenda.
Thank you, Bob.
Second.
Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, next up we have Mac Williams with the Economic Incentives, Lotus Bakeries.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
I'm Mac Williams, President of the Alamance Chamber, and I'm very excited this morning to introduce a new project for Alamance County, Lotus Bakeries. We've been working with these guys for much of the year as they go through their site selection process, and now we're proud to be, at least at this point, the first option, and hopefully we can get through the day today. We've got you folks this morning, we've got Mevin tonight, and then we've got some other activities to get through as well. But starting today, hopefully we can bring a $55 million bakery that employs 60 people with good manufacturing jobs with a international company, global brand. You all recognize it. In fact, I think they some of the product that they're going to make with them this morning, so I hope they'll do that. But we're excited about this project. It's puts Alamance County on the map again with another great company, and we hope that you'll feel the same way. We've got the gentleman with the company who is going to manage the facility here from Belgium this morning. And I'm going to let Bart come up and introduce himself. Then he's got a presentation about the company that he'd like to go through with you. And then we can open it up for questions and any comments you might have about the project itself and the incentive agreement. And then go from there, open it up to the public as well. They've got a good story to tell, and I'm excited to have them here to help tell it. So we also have with us this morning the consultants that worked with the company in their site location process with Cushman & Wakefield out of the Chicago office. And so we've got lots of interested parties with us this morning. We're glad to have those guys, and they can also help answer any questions should that be required. So we're happy to have those guys with Cushman & Wakefield with us this morning as well. So with that, Bart, you want to come up and introduce yourself? And
yes, please.
Welcome to Alamance County. We're glad to have you here this morning. All right.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thanks for having me and allowing me to introduce our company a bit further to you. I'll try to walk it fast enough. But if you have questions, if you want supplementary information, I'll be glad to give it to you. Thanks a lot. So we're Lotus Bakeries. We're a Belgium-based cookie manufacturer. We're family-owned business, actually founded in 1932. At that point, it was one type of cookie, the cookie that we call speculoos in Belgium, that is known under the name Biscoff in the States. That's actually the cookie where it all started, and which was launched by the family Bohnen, which would be pronounced Boone in the States, in 1932 already, and actually until today the cookie had some changes. We made it a bit healthier than then, but the taste should still relate. Maybe some dates that are important. I think 1985 is an important one for the States, because that was actually the first time the Biscoff cookie was sampled in the States on the flights from Delta Airlines. And until today it still is. So a lot of people, if you see the Delta cookie, should recognize it. It's that product that we want to manufacture here now. Since 2001, we had some mergers along the way, had different brands coming together. Since 2001, we have the one global brand being Lotus that we use around the globe now. Other dates show that we are fast growing today, and that actually the last few years, almost every 2 years or every 3 years, we had an acquisition being of a sales office that we made our own. So we use a company that is providing, that's doing the sales at first when we get to know the market. Was the same thing in the States, but at a certain point, we when we see that the market is going to work, we like to become full owner of our company there. And you also see the date in 2009, we became full owner of Lotus Bakeries North America. That's Lotus around the globe. So actually the colored ones are where we have our own business. So being in Europe, manufacturing business as well as sales. Outside of Europe, Asia, USA, today we already have our sales offices that we own. And then in the gray parts of the world, we have distributors that do the distribution for us. And actually, the white parts are parts that we still need to develop, but we're planning on having the entire globe eating our cookies. Our product, that's what makes us great, what we're producing. So Biscoff, if you don't know it yet, you should hurry to your local retail store and get to know it, because it really is the best cookie in the world. The name Biscoff comes from biscuits and coffee. So it's actually a cookie that goes really good together with coffee. In Europe, some people even soak it in their coffee before they eat it. And we have been able to examine and to prove that it's really two complementary tastes. And in the meanwhile, we also developed, I think since 2008, a Biscoff spread. So that's actually a spread really made out of those cookies mixed together, which makes it easier to, some people eat it just by the spoon, okay, I might be fattening at that point, but even on pancakes, on waffles, I can only recommend it. So, and this is actually the group of products we're talking about today that we would want to start manufacturing in this region. In Belgium, we have more. We have specialty cakes, especially for the Belgian market, a bit in France. We have a lot of waffles. They are actually growing quite fast in Europe as well. Belgium, Germany, the Netherlands, France, Spain. It's a market that is going really well as well. We have our dinosaur. It's a product that where we get the license. We bought the license in 2012. It's going really good in the kids market, Belgium, France especially. Peenemburg, this is actually a Dutch brand, and that's a bit proof how we work. We look for companies in other countries with the same DNA, and then there was an acquisition of Peenemburg. This is actually the market leader. It's gingerbread, very popular at breakfast in the Netherlands, but also more and more throughout the day. So that's how we grow companies that have similar products, similar DNA. We try to get those in the group. Same thing, typical Swedish product, and this is one you might know, that's Anna's pepparkakor. It's actually also a spiced biscuit from Sweden that's also well represented on the American market. Actually, it was on American retail well before Biscoff was, so, and it will remain, of course. And then our newer brands, those are companies only acquired in 2013 till 2015, one even, I think. It's more the healthy snacks. So we could recommend, like in the morning you have our Biscoff, but then you don't want to get fat, so in the afternoon you might do a healthy snack. Our strategy is actually for each market the same. We try to create products, SKUs that work for a certain market. We trial a bit, we have a bit of trial and error, we do some sampling. Actually, we almost never get the error, but okay, it's a process of trial and error. We let it build slowly, and actually when we get at the point that we see it really building up, that we see people liking our product, we try to accelerate it, that process, and become one of the market leaders. And actually, that's a bit the point we are now in the States. We see our cookie getting purchased by a lot of retailers. We see our success growing on airline companies. But there, to really have that acceleration, we need production facilities now. Product is on the way 4 to 5 weeks overseas. It's already less fresh when it gets here. So actually, the moment we will be manufacturing here, it will be fresher and even better for people that didn't think that was possible. It is, and it will. One thing I wanted to show out of our strategy as well is that we're also always trying to work from a point of view of sustainability. And that's one of the advantages that we have. We are founded as a family company, but we also still are a family company. The chairman of the board of directors is still a family member, our CEO is still a family member. So they don't just want to make a profit, they don't just want to grow, they also want to be able to be proud of their company. And there's where this story of sustainability kicks in, and actually everybody that we work with, we try to get to know our program called Care for Today, Respect for Tomorrow. It's actually built on 4 pillars. It's people, and by people we mean the people that are eating and buying our products. We want healthy products. We want products that are also that you would want to give to your children. I always tell people in our factories, they should have a hard time not eating all the cookies that come off the conveyors. If they know what's in it, they know how it's processed, if they like to eat them, people in the stores will like to eat them and buy them. We have the environmental issue as well on our production processes, as like for example for transportation. That's also one of the things why we want to come here. Now you're having a lot of transportations to bring the product from Belgium to the States, and you have large sales here, so we want to be local. We look into renewable energy sources and so on. Society, we always try to take a place in local society, so it's something we're going to want to do here as well. I think I should look back at Johan. How is the program called that we already have in the US?
In the US we have a partnership with Teach for America.
So that's one of the things we're already doing, but we see all around our production facilities, we see what's going on in local community and how we can participate on that. And then also on our employees, we want our employees to be healthy, to be to work in a safe way, to be involved in the company. We have actually 3 company values for that, called the top values: team spirit, open dialogue, and passion. And that's something we want to feel in everyone that works for us. So that's a bit our sustainability program that I wanted to show you. So on the organization level, we are a company with corporate headquarters in Lembeke, Belgium. So what you see there is our executive committee. From the left to the right, you have William Dupré, he's director of General Corporate Services. You have Ignaz Heyman, who is our chief operations officer. You have Jan Bone, our chief executive officer. And on the right, you have Isabel Maas, our chief financial officer. So they are corporately controlling the company. And then actually you get a management team for each country where we have our own organization. So in the lower left you see the United States, and the picture is Michelle Singer. She's our general manager for the U.S. And headquarters for the U.S. are situated in San Francisco, California. Turnover and results. Well, it's always nice to be able to show that not only our product is delicious, but that we're also doing very well as a company. So that's actually our sales figures in million euros. And it takes about $1.1 per euro. But what the important thing is that you see, if you look from 2005 till 2015, is that we almost tripled sales in 10 years' time after an economical crisis. So I think we might be really proud of that result. We also have a notation on the Brussels Stock Exchange, and there we were in the newspapers last year. If you look at the average value of the Brussels Stock Exchange, we have beaten that value 18 years in a row with the Lotus stock. So. On the level of employees, we have in the meantime around 1,400 people working for us. It's a bit of 50-50 on the level men-women. You see, at this point, it's especially focused in our home markets, Belgium, Netherlands, and France. Reason for that is because we have our manufacturing plants there. So Belgium, it's 5 manufacturing plants plus corporate headquarters. Netherlands is 2 manufacturing plants, France as well, 2 smaller ones. So you see, for the time being, United States 17, but that is a number that will go up once we're manufacturing here as well. And then a bit fixing on the American story. So actually, first sign of Lotus in the States was Anna starting selling here in 1981. But I should be honest about that. At that time, Anna's wasn't part of the Lotus group yet. So it's not really, it wasn't Lotus at that time. It is Lotus now. Lotus itself, as I mentioned, started here in 1985. And so two important milestones there. So at first we worked with Gourmet Center, a joint venture for distribution here. In 2009, we actually got our own sales office and we became full owner of our own organization. And the year before, in 2008, we acquired Anas, so that made it also easier to gain position on this market. And I think in 2013, at first, it was an office Americas in general. 2013, we have a focused sales office for Latin America now, that is in Chile. So, back to show you some of the retailers that are already working with us, some more locally, some nationwide. Okay, the only thing we have to do today, we're already in a lot of stores, but you still need to know what you're looking for and you need to look for our product. I hope in 10 years' time you won't be able to look at anything else and you will see Lotus top down as we have it in Belgium now. So really excited for that. A word on the project. I know you have been kept in intention long enough. So actually, what were we looking for in a location for a manufacturing plant? First thing, actually, and that's where we were helped by the consulting of Cushman & Wakefield, was we wanted areas with high-quality labor force available. So that was the first point in selection. Another thing was the cost of doing business. And also the business friendliness, the business climate you feel in a certain area. We also wanted or needed real estate that suited our demands. And in suiting our demands, we also look for options for expandability. You never know what the future is going to bring, but I've shown you our growth rates. We're not starting up a manufacturing plant anywhere in the idea that that's our final point. We're jumping into this adventure, believing in the growth possibilities in the US. And I should also maybe emphasize once more that it's a big step. Biscoff was the product of the family Bono. They had it since 1932, and since 1932 it has only been produced in Lambeek, Belgium, near to Ghent, their hometown. And they really wanted to keep it there, so for them it's really letting their baby taking its first steps into the wide world, so it's a huge step to go out of Belgium and out of Lambeek to have a production. And also we want to feel a fit with the company DNA. As I mentioned before, it's really important for us that we are able to get a workforce that fits in everything that Lotus stands for. So we also wanted an area where we had the feeling of that fit with the company DNA. And I think I'm even more biased than everybody else in the project, as I'm planning to come to live near to the company with my family. I have 2 daughters, 2 and 4 years old, so for me it's also really important that we get a good community to see them grow up in. Which products will we make? To show how fast the growth is going, I think when we first were talking about this project, we were like thinking, like everybody, we will put up 1 manufacturing installation, 1 production line, and we see where we go from there. Today we have grown so much in the US already that we will immediately start with 2-3 production installations. So we will make 1 with family packs, 1 with 2-piece packs, and those 2-piece packs are also what you typically see for the airplane companies as well. So you have the Delta cookie. The last 6 months you also had this cookie on American airline flights, so there's a large market there. And there's also our Biscoff spread that we want to produce from the start on. So what are we looking into on the level of workforce? It's actually everything you need to make our cookies. So going from warehouse workers that do the reception of our raw materials and our packaging materials, through operators for dough making, for baking, for packaging, and then everything that comes around there. The cleaning services that you need, a good maintenance department is important, quality management, etc. Project overview, if I'm looking a bit at the timeline. So now we're at the point, Q3 of 2016, that we're looking at the site selection. So we're actually at this point in the middle of all our due diligences as well for the real estate part, as for the incentives part on different levels. So we hope that all starts to fall into place, and today is an important day, as Mac mentioned, for that. We hope to be able to start construction then in the first half of 2017, which should allow us then to bring in our machines in time and to get our machines started to be fully operational in the first half of 2019. So what do we have to offer you? Well, we have a long-running company, and not only long-running, but longly owned by the same family. Our CEO has been appointed CEO only for, I think, 3 or 4 years. So it's actually the next generation. It's the 3rd generation of Bonus. So also at that point, we're not at the point that the company is going to change leadership. We see ourselves as an excellent corporate citizen because we believe in our values, and we want to bring our values to the community. But on the other hand, we also want to be a player in the community, and that means also taking in the values that are offered by the community and being part of it. At that point, we try to take a humble position and not coming here and thinking we will learn everybody everything, but I think every step I've made here so far, I'm the one who is learning, and I think that will continue for many years. We also believe that we have a strong brand name, and it's a brand name that will strongly grow in the years to come, so we think that also that is an asset for local community as well as state level. We're looking into long-term employment creation. I think I can be quite clear on that. We weren't looking at just buildings that were available. We needed a partner that was willing to build what really we really need. We won't buy a box and putting our production lines in it. We developed the production lines as they should optimally be, and we're looking into it with the developer to build the ideal building around it. So I don't think you do that if you think we might be gone in 5 years' time. And even there, I'm having discussions with builders. I think in the States, people built a building that would last 30 or 40 years. In Europe, we built for 100 or 200 years, so we're still having discussions on that. But if we come here, it's to stay here. And we think we have a strong company culture and a mission, and with the growth, with everything that Lotus stands for, that can make people proud to work for us, to be our neighbors, to be able to say that cookie when in 10 years' time it's as large as Oreo, to be able to say it's our product at Lotus Biscoff. So it's what we're trying to bring here. And that you will maybe get to know, I will for sure get to know it. It's a cup of coffee with Lotus Biscoff under its arm, because that's one of the things we want to learn people. If you get a coffee, you should already be looking where your Biscoff is.
I have been.
That's it from my side.
Very good. Thank you very much. Hit the lights, man.
We ask questions?
Yeah, I think, and then we'll go into public hearing.
All right. The average salaries we're projecting, or at least in the agreement, it was $36,000.
I'm sorry.
$35,931.
And would that include fringe benefits, or would the fringe benefits be in addition to that number?
They would be in addition. I think we looked at the base salary, and also there we have to look further into it, but we made an estimate of what kind of personnel we need, and then together with Cushman and Wakefield, we looked into it, what the average wages were around here, and we try to pay above average. We always try to get a correct payment of our employees. So yeah, if the number shifts a bit, but the benefits packages still needs to come on top.
So that would that include health insurance for the employees too?
Yes, I can't say to date until what level, but it will be market conform for this area. But that's also something from the moment we've passed the due diligences that we should look into deeper than if we have a final place to build our factory, what there the numbers are exactly. First this was looked as regionally enlarged, but it will be looked at deeper into detail.
So are most of your employees full-time 40-hour employees?
Yes.
Okay.
That's the idea.
And what is your projected headcount for your when it's fully staffed?
Well, I think we projected now until 2020, and we were around 60 or 65, something like that.
60 in the agreement.
I think if we fulfill our full growth, it will go over 100, but okay, that's the unknowns of the future.
Yeah. How does this size of this facility compare to other manufacturing plants you have in other countries?
It will actually become the second largest production plant in volume output that we will generate. So we have one in Lambeke, our mother plant for Biscoff, and at this point it is almost as large as all our other facilities together. We have a volume growth on Biscoff worldwide that the past 2 years, and as it looks forward in the budgets, it will be as like that the next year as well. We have an annual growth of 20% in volume. So they're actually glad that we're taking some volume away there. And so we expect, I think for the US maybe the growth numbers won't be 20%, but we're looking at above 5 anyway, so that would make that this plant would also grow every year, but I think at startup it will be ex aequo second. So from every growth we make, we will become the second plant in the group. So actually, after the mother plant that was grew out of the first plant, they started in 1932. So.
As a type 2 diabetic, do you have any sugar-free cookies?
Didn't bring one today, right?
Well, as I said, we're working on it, but it won't be the Biscoff cookie. Indeed, the Biscoff cookie in itself is a caramelized biscuit, and you don't caramelize without the sugar, so I have to disappoint you on that. But I'm willing to look into it to maybe if we can do something for that.
I have sampled your cookies, and they are very good. I was looking for one on the desk this morning, stuck in my coffee. But
that's already
see
reflex.
Where your sincerity was. Anyhow, when you were looking at Alamance County, what are the skills that you were looking at in employee availability? What were those things that you looked for in choosing us?
We had two parts. Employees, type of problem-solving employees. By that I mean our processes for food are highly automated. So it's not before we had a lot of employees who needed to take the biscuits and put them in the lane. That's all done by robots now. So now we actually need operators of a type that are able to do good quality control, that can regulate on the process based on that quality control, that can react when a machine has mistaking or a machine goes down for some reasons, that they can react on that. So I think they're looking into operator level, not the highest, it's not rocket science either,
right.
But they should be able to think for themselves. And then a few management profiles. You need a basic management team for the plant where you have a technical manager, planning manager, production manager.
Okay.
So, and then I think we have some people for the paperwork side of the planning, the orders coming in, order controlling and so on, so.
Right. In your shipping, most of it is done via truck once it gets into
yes.
the state, is
yes.
that correct?
And there we will probably, we do it today, and we will continue working with third-party logistics provider. So actually, that they do our logistics.
So you will hire someone
else. We
have
basic logistics in the plant, and we will have a warehouse, but then that we can buy truck every day, send it to their warehouse, and they'll manage the chain.
Okay, so that's other jobs that you will create
yeah.
via
yeah.
that.
Indirect, because now this is in... this is done especially through when it comes from Belgium through Chicago area, so this will need to be more local as well.
Right.
Indeed.
Okay.
I suppose in your search you became aware of our Alamance Community College and the mechatronics program that they're starting there, and
yeah.
the all the other technological training that's being done, also yeah. in conjunction with our public school system.
Absolutely. It's one of the things that got us excited, even. We had CNW providing us all that information, but I think our general manager, or at least her husband, was born in this area, and she was saying we're having the best schools in the States over there. Don't know if that's sustained by numbers, but in each case,
it's
we're working on it. We have a goal to be a national model public education
there
system.
You go. Here, so. We are working towards that.
Would it be appropriate to ask a question about the agreement?
I think it's proper if you want to.
Okay. That's well, fair. I was, you know, this is a big investment that you're proposing, and mm-hmm. and normally when we review packages, we don't do that much on an upfront basis, so this one requires quite a bit of upfront
investment. From our part.
Yeah, and in some ways that gives me a little bit of pause because there's a certain amount of risk perhaps associated with that. Your company looks very successful, so maybe that risk is very, very low, but things happen unexpectedly, and airline business could go down or something. Of course, that's not probably that big of a part of your business. But In this isn't a concern of yours, but we do have this is going to come out of our fund balance from a
right,
cash flow perspective,
front
so it may decrease It'll weaken our balance sheet for a while, and I was kind of curious as to how important that upfront investment on our part is versus using the same dollars but spreading it out over time.
Well, first of all, maybe still a word on the risk factor from the company. So I think if you look at our balances, I think we're in a position that we can pay back all our debt in a year and a half, which is really fast. But I understand your position there. The thing I have to say, we looked at the proposal that was on the table. We calculated net present values based on that, and they looked really good. So we'd see if we spread it out, okay, then we have to look at what this means for the net present value of the total project. So it's something that can be discussed, but yeah, we should, if we immediately have the cash, it would make sense that the amount would go up a bit if it's more spread than if it's up front, well, and the calculations that we did now.
You have to keep your net present value the same, the amount would have to go up. But,
And my understanding, maybe this is for Craig, in here it says the payment of $442,000 will be paid over 4 years,
right?
Correct?
Yes, sir.
And that first payment will be after the certificate of occupancy for the building is actually done.
Sir.
So they're going to invest their money up front, really, to get this building to that point.
Where our upfront is the 356, and that gives them the cash flow to begin doing their project, that they will not get any more dollars until the CO is complete.
Okay.
So once the CO is complete, then we will pay them the first year of our cash grant, which is $221,000, and then we will do that over a 5 year. There's five equal payments.
It's five payments, not four.
Right. I was reading the second part of it. Yeah. But so where are our assurances? Maybe that's a question for you and Clyde.
We do have them in, and again, this is a joint agreement with the city of Mebane, and so they're paying really the same upfront that we are, the same incentive, the 221 at CO, and then 4 years after that. Mebane is also putting in $96,000 worth of fees that they're waiving. So we do appreciate working with the city of Mebane. What we do on our investment and our job numbers is before incentives are paid, we go back and make sure that they're meeting the requirements. If they're not meeting, then we will adjust based upon the percentage they're not meeting. So based on jobs and of investment. But if they're over, if they actually invest more than $55.3 million, they don't get anything more. Mm-hmm. So we're capped at our incentive at $55.3
million. So I did a little cash flow analysis myself. And so the upfront payment, that's
right.
The 356.
That's really what's going to affect our fund balance. Starting when we do the first $221,000 payment, that same year we ought to get a tax payment from the company.
Yeah.
And the way I calculate on a $55.3 million investment, that would be approximately a $320,000.
So that would pretty much give us the
So that would be like $100,000 more than
what we're paying out.
So that's coming back, but it's going to take a few years at $100,000 a year to get repaid that initial upfront.
Right.
And there's going to be like a 2 year time from the time that we would give that upfront payment until your project is up and ready and starting to run.
We are being fairly aggressive on this part and recommending being aggressive on this, because this is probably, and Mac and I were talking earlier, this is the third largest single investment in Alamance County from a private company between Lidl and Walmart. We definitely know it's in the top five in all of history. But with this being a global company, with this being a food manufacturing company, And it's also very structured how we did Walmart and Lidl as well, with an upfront. The difference for us is on Walmart and Lidl is Graham and Mevin actually put the upfront money in, because at the time we were working with Walmart and Lidl, our cash flow was not at the point where we could. With our fund balance now at almost 23-24%, we have that flexibility, and that's what the reason why we're being a little bit more aggressive now.
So I have always thought that one way to keep our tax rates down is to make sure we broaden our tax base, and this is a big,
that's a big investment move on their part. Future, yes, yeah, not so. Right now, but in the future, yeah.
So I guess the main difference between what we normally have done is that this is a much larger company than what we're normally dealing with.
Right.
It's not as large as Walmart.
And the upfront.
I mean, I like what you said about the value proposition. I think it would be a good quality company for our community.
What I can add, if I may, is that I have full understanding of your cash flow position, so I understand your reflection on that. But I can also add that we appreciate it very much. The incentives aren't what are making our investments. We were willing to invest, and we were going to invest in the United States. The question was, where are we going to invest? Mm-hmm. And we've appreciated very much the strong workforce that is shown here, but also the strong business climate and the willingness to work together, the aggressiveness of the bidding. So it is something that pleased us very much.
Thank you for your consideration.
Yeah, we feel very honored that you're to this point in considering coming here.
And we have brought in national companies, and I think this speaks highly to that and will help in the future also. Okay.
Thank Mac.
Thanks, Mac.
All the work that you did to this point.
Yeah. If there's no more questions from you guys, I'm going to open it up if you want to have a seat, and we'll open it up for a public hearing so that the public can weigh in on this. We'll just start right over here on the left. If there's anyone that would, first, I need a motion to go into public hearing, I think, right?
That's
correct. Okay.
I'll second.
Roger, thank you. Bob, all in favor?
Aye.
All right, now we're going to open it up. Anyone on this side that would like to speak to it?
Morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Ryan Hall from Samet. You've heard from a great company. What a great opportunity that we have. This is due in large part to the teamwork that's been put in place, the investments that you've made, the work that we've all done over the years to have an opportunity like this. You heard Craig say, one of the top five potential investments that's ever been made in the county. Can't stress to you enough how important it is that you support it. Thank you.
Brian, before you leave, I got a question. The rail spur, I think I've seen that this is coming to completion soon.
Yeah, so I got an email on Friday from Norfolk Southern that they have activated the switch.
And is this something the company will look into in the future?
They
maybe
truck all their products, okay. So I don't know that the rail spur is critical to them, but I'm working on it for the next guy.
Okay, very good. Thank you. All right, anyone else on this side of the right side? All right, with that, I'll take a motion to close the public hearing.
Make a motion.
Thank you, Roger.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Now we'll entertain a motion to accept this agreement.
I'll make a motion.
Thank you.
We accept.
Okay.
A motion to accept.
Okay.
I'll second it. But I would, Susan, maybe not now, but at some point in the new future, could kind of help us with the cash flows of our fund balance, because we've done a lot of approving in recent weeks
of
and months of
things, that
things that's
that,
coming out, yeah. And if we could get some projections about.
Right. And this payout, exact date of this will be?
I think once the agreement is signed, and there's all, I think there's a lot of things that have to, there's some state agreements, there's Mevin's agreement, and there's ours, so we'll let you know. But I would say if approved by all parties, it would be this not be before December, okay. If that's it.
Does that sound correct?
Okay. I have asked for a list of, and I think it's where you're coming from, yeah. Mm-hmm. On the list of all the Right. Incentive that we have done over the, since I've been here.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. And also a timeline and where and what impact we're having to, you know, that, to our fund balance and all this.
And that's would be very good. And I also want to kind of get a
other
sense.
Things have got
yeah, all the things balance, that we've approved yeah. that's impacting the fund balance and what we think is going to happen up between now and the end of the fiscal year.
Okay. Right.
So.
Mr. Chairman, if I could just say, isn't it wonderful to be dealing with problems of success?
Yes.
Well, and I think it's important with economic development that we take the long view. That's what
right.
I'm going to vote for this.
And,
but,
and then infrastructure built here to help support everything we work to do.
That's exactly right. Yeah.
And this is a solid company.
Yep.
I mean, there's
right.
no doubt about that.
So you folks might want to buy some stock in the company. Anyhow, we have a motion and a second. I'll take a vote on this. Aye.
Uh-huh. All right.
No opposition. So here we go. Thank you guys
very much.
Very much.
All right.
If y'all would like to be dismissed, I know you have a lot to do while you're in the States.
Maybe if I may add one thing, we don't have our product on us now. It's in a warehouse in Mevin, but I promise you we will look with Mac to make sure that it gets here next time if you come back.
Thank you very much.
Can we get a standard plug?
All right, very good. As they dismiss, we'll
look into that sugar free.
Yeah. Oh, who's here to this, for this? Fire prevention.
Debbie is, or Debbie. Or is it John?
John.
Oh, there's John. Okay.
All right. Next thing, we have a proclamation for fire prevention, and actually I'm going to come down and give this to John.
Yeah. Thank God.
Fire Prevention Week, October 9th through the 15th. Whereas the well-being of our county citizens requires that families, community, emergency workers, and health professionals work together to ensure the highest levels of public safety. This goal is particularly important with respect to fire prevention. The most recent statistical data, 2014, from the National Fire Protection Association shows there were 1,298,000 fires reported in the United States. And these fires caused 3,275 civilian deaths, 15,775 civilian injuries, and 11.6 billion in property damage. 494,000 were structure fires, causing 2,860 civilian deaths, 13,425 civilian injuries, and 9.8 billion in property damage. 193,500 were vehicle fires, causing 345 civilian fire deaths, 1,450 civilian fire injuries, and 1.5 billion in property damage. 610,500 were outside and other fires, causing 70 civilian fire deaths, 900 civilian fire injuries, and 237 million in property damage. Whereas in the United States, fire caused by cooking, heating, or electricity amount to almost half of all home fires. These accidental fires, though common, are also among the most preventable. Their high rates of occurrence point to the vital importance of safety and knowledge in helping to prevent these types of fires and thereby avoid the tragic deaths and serious injuries that they can cause. Whereas this year marks the annual observance of the Fire Prevention Week sponsored by the National Fire Protection Association, it is the desire of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners and the Alamance County Fire Marshal's Office to encourage our citizens to take an active role in preventing home fires and injuries and deaths they cause by conducting fire safety inspection, preparing and practicing home fire drills. Whereas during this year's observance, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners would also call on fellow citizens in joining us and expressing our appreciation for the devotion and dedication of our county's firefighters and other emergency response personnel. These brave men and women provide the first line of emergency response to a multitude of disasters and risk their own security and well-being to save the lives of others. They serve to make our towns, cities, and communities safer places for all. Now, therefore, it be resolved that we, the Alamance County Board of Commissioners, do hereby proclaim October 9th through October 15th, 2016, as Fire Prevention Week in Alamance County. We call upon our fellow citizens to further awareness of fire safety practice and renew efforts to prevent fires and their tragic consequences for human health and safety. And with that, I'm going to present this to you, and if you have any words of wisdom for us this morning to help work on fires.
I just want to thank you, Chairman, Commissioners, for proclaiming this week for us next week. Several years ago, we were pretty active out in the public with the schools. We will be participating next week with each three inspectors will be visiting a school with a county fire department to help them in county fire prevention. I know when I worked in the city of Mebane, it's a good feeling whenever a second grader would come through in the following year, they'd come back and they say, you know, we done our exit drill in the house and we done our meeting spot, so it's good for us to get out and help proclaim, you know, that we are supportive of fire prevention in the county.
Well, I personally appreciate it, and I think last week was an example with the little flooding we had down the Washita Road. I think
Debbie
was
that's correct.
Pushing on that, and I'm sure you guys
that's
were close by hand.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you for all you do.
Thank you.
All right. Jeremy, I think you're the spotlight next with some tax revalve answers.
Thank you, Commissioners. The good folks at Lotus got away. I was going to mention that whenever I fly Delta, which is my preferred flight, the best part is when they bring up that little cup of coffee with a little Biscoff cookie. So I'm in favor of more of those. With material like going over the schedule of values, I don't want to bore anybody. I want to make sure that it's nothing too laborious. And so I borrowed off of some comedians I've seen, and I brought props today. I did want to show you, this is our 2009 schedule of values. This is the one that's currently in force that's coming to a close. You can note the weight of the volume there, and this is our proposed 2017 schedule. You might notice somewhat of a difference between the two. And when you look at them, you have to ask yourself, what's missing? Something's missing here. In fact, there's nothing of substance that is missing. If you looked at our old 85, 93, and 2001 schedules, they look like this. What was done in 2009 was to print, first of all, on heavy cardstock, second of all, one-sided, and third, when that didn't get there, to just start photocopying things and adding them in. And it made for very impressive volume, but the goal is a lack of transparency. The idea is that, well, no one was going to take the time to look through this. And the goal with our schedule now, as it has been in the past, is to be transparent. We are here to serve the citizens, not to hide what we're doing. And hopefully anyone that would pick up the schedule and read it would be able to decode and understand what it is that we're doing. That's one of our goals. Let me see which button does which on this. So to talk about the schedule, my first question is, what is a schedule of values? When I came to the department 10 years ago, I thought schedules were, you know, calendars and appointments and things like that. The schedule of values is basically our procedural and pricing handbook. It gives us our base rates and tables, our adjustments, and our methodologies that we're going to use to value all property, real property throughout the county. It even controls our specific coding. The idea is that we need to be on a standard. When you pick up one of our property record cards, you should be able to interpret the same items the same way every single time. And so once we put a schedule in place for the remainder of our reval cycle, we're all on the same page. So where did the schedule come from? We developed our schedule in-house. This is something I'm very proud of. I spent quite a few hours poring over it and refining it. Mr. Mincy, our senior appraiser, is here with me that developed the commercial side. I know just enough about commercial to be dangerous, so he took care of the commercial side for us. The process that was used, in step one, we look back at the 85, the 93, the 2001, and the 2009 schedules. Basically, what we're looking for is where do they agree and where do they disagree? Because it's very meaningful to me if there's agreement between these various schedules. And when there's disagreement, I need to do some research. This kind of gave us a framework. This was a starting point to say this is what the schedule addresses and this is how the schedule functions. Now, following that, we looked at over 5,000 sales in the last 3 years. We also looked at cost manuals such as RS Means and Marshall & Swift. And we also looked at currently advertised costs in the market to begin to develop our base rates. So what the old schedules can give us is a form, but it can't give us a number. We have to get that from the current market. Now once we've got the form and some rates, we need to test them. So we built a number of hypothetical models. And basically I would run Marshall & Swift back against the hypothetical. I'd run it in Marshall & Swift, I'd run it in our schedule. And we see, are we high, are we low, are we approximating a very similar point? After those refinements were made, we want to look at real data, not just hypotheticals. So we go out and we begin to pull market sales. Is our model matching back to market sales? Wherever we find a discrepancy, we begin to make adjustments to our model. Now at this point, we're becoming pretty confident that we've got a workable model, so we input it into the computer system and run it on every parcel in Alamance County and run it against every sale that we have to compare. This lets us make some refinements. For example, you can go to each one of your rates for each one of your components, and you can tweak it a little bit up, tweak it a little bit down, and then rerun the entire county and see if statistically are we closer to the mark or further away. Now this is very time consuming, but it's one of the best ways to do final calibration. Is you know that you're pretty close, and you have now the ability to try it on with all the sales available and see was that a little bit closer, a little bit further out, to get that final calibration. At this point, it goes into the hands of our appraisal staff, and they begin to work on a neighborhood by neighborhood basis, applying and using the schedule. And this cannot be overstated, that the real work of appraisal happens with the appraisers. It doesn't happen with the book. The book gives them the common basis that they need. But at the end of the day, real human beings have to make those appraisals. And so based on the way that they applied and used them, we got feedback from the appraisal staff. We made some final refinements to make sure that it was meeting their needs and their ability to assess property. Once we had that in place, we put it on paper. And that's the document that we have before you here. Like I say, it's very streamlined as compared to the last schedule, but it's pretty
hold
much on par.
Hold both up for Thomas. He needs a picture. Huh?
Get a couple of people pick that one up.
Yeah, no, I know. Can't hold
I'm too tired now. I can't lift anymore. Yeah, so that's the story of where the schedule comes from. I think the best way to just get a quick overview of what it does and how it works is to run through a residential example, a commercial example. The schedule is divided into a residential section and a commercial section. Rather than to get into all the individual rates, just look at the process and see the basic theme of how this schedule is going to work. Beginning with the residential example, the first thing that you have to do is specify the structure type. So for example, I can say that it's a site-built dwelling, an off-frame modular, an on-frame modular. It could be a double wide, it could be a single wide, it could be a townhouse, it could be a duplex, it could be a multi-story condo building. Each one of these structure types is going to have its own base rates, its own depreciation tables, and its own size tables. Once I select a type, so for example, it could just be a site-built home, I would select that type. I now can get a base value. And all that is the base rate for that type times the square footage of the living area. Comes back to a base value. But what we have to do now is begin to refine that base value. Now, residentially, we work off of a model that you're dealing with a three-bedroom, two-bath, 1,500 square foot, one-story, new home with vinyl siding on crawl space. There are assumptions that are being made in the background. Those assumptions aren't always true to every property. And this is where we're going to begin to build in the specifications for an individual property. So for example, heated living area on the second story is assessed at a reduced rate. Homes that are larger or smaller than average are adjusted to account for economy of scale and diminishing return. Homes are adjusted for quality of construction, depreciation according to age and condition, any unrepaired damage, functional obsolescence, economic obsolescence, and percentage of completion if not at 100%. Running through these adjustments, we now get to an adjusted base value. Yes?
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
So nobody came to my home and came inside. Well, maybe you drove by my home, right?
What should happen is someone should have come to the door and walked around the home. Now, we don't actually come inside unless it's new construction, where we can get inside while it's under construction. Or on appeal, if someone invites us to come into their home, we certainly do go in and look at the interior. Otherwise, we're limited to exterior dimensions, and we have to make an assumption here. The assumption is that the interior is reflected by the exterior. Sometimes that's not true. The interior may be significantly better or worse than what the exterior would convey.
So somebody could have come to my door and I wasn't home and they weren't going to keep coming back until I got here.
Yes. Okay. And what we did for control on that is that they were required to turn in pictures from the front and the rear of the property to document their visit so that we can go back. We should be able to pull up your property to find a picture from the front, and if they could get access to the rear, picture of the rear of the home showing that.
Plus on GIS there's a sketch of your house right there that for square footage purpose.
Exactly. But yeah. But you're right, we do have to work from the exterior outside of appeals or new construction.
And you're not getting extra for that crawl space. So you won't have to pay as much tax on it.
That's right. So those are the general adjustments that are used for each of these types residentially. But there's also component adjustments. So the number of bathrooms comes into play, the type of siding material, your foundation, heating, cooling system, electrical system. We look at the insulation, there's adjustment for that. Residential elevators, we actually have residential elevators in Alamance County. There's a number of them in place, and when they're present, we need to make an adjustment for that. We also adjust for areas outside of the heated living area. For example, if you've got a basement, an attic, porches, patios, landings and stoops, garages and carports, shops, utility rooms, attached greenhouses. Each area has its own base rate and size adjustment. Each one is individually adjusted for quality, condition and age, functional obsolescence, and percentage of completion. So we try to be detailed. Mass appraisal is assembly line appraisal. You're coming down the conveyor belt and you're putting the pieces on, you're taking the pieces off, and then at the end of the process you have a value. And where you can get into trouble is when you fail to recognize the specifics of the property you're assessing. You get so caught up in the process that you stop seeing the subject property. And so what we try to do is to make sure that all the individual factors that affect value are taken into account for each individual property. Additionally, there's neighborhood level adjustments. So in certain neighborhoods, the exact same house will sell for more because the neighborhood is applying an upward market force. In other neighborhoods, the same house will sell for less. The neighborhood's applying a downward market force. Within any neighborhood, generally the largest, highest quality home is being pulled down by its neighbors, and the smallest, lowest quality home is being pulled up by its neighbors. So we have to adjust for these neighborhood forces. We can't do an abstraction. The house lives in a real location, you know, the old real estate maxim, location, location, location. And so once we've done everything else, we also need to consider where is this house. Additionally, we need to value the land. We do this either by the lot or by the acre. So when it's valued by the lot, it has a common base value. It doesn't change for minor differences in size. If we say a lot's $30,000, then throughout the neighborhood, it's just 30, no matter if it's a little smaller, a little bit larger. We can also value by the acre, in which case we do adjust the exact size of the land. Land assessed on acre basis may be valued as home site, residual, development, non-perk, or floodplain. Base rates for land are based on land sales, so we try to see if land is sold recently. Known improved to unimproved land ratio. So if I don't have any good land sales, but I know the ratio the land normally comprises in a sale, I can back that out of an improved sale. And mathematical extraction of land value. So if I have a good estimate of what the value of the home is, I can back the home out of that improved sale to find out what residual is left for the land. So those are the three basic approaches to pull these land values in. We do keep land rates consistent within a neighborhood, but it does vary between neighborhoods. So you should be able to look at your neighbors, and they should be on the same land rates that you're on. If you go across town, they may have different rates. We do make adjustments with land just like we do with the improvement. We adjust for access, for floodplain, topography. We adjust for shape, easements, location. Less common adjustments, we adjust for associated parcels, conservation easements, contamination, economic misimprovements, deed restrictions, and severed mineral rights. We also have a user-defined adjustment because there is, once in a while, kind of an odd case with land. In addition, we also have to value the accessory structures. So this would include things like detached garages and carports, detached shops, shelters and sheds, fences and driveways, entertaining areas, pool and lake-related structures, and light agricultural structures we'll pick up. A true heavy agricultural structure ends up really on the commercial side of the equation, but light agricultural is picked up on the residential side. And very simply, they're adjusted for their own base rate size adjustment for tables, quality, age, condition, physical, functional, etc. At the end of the day, we're going to take the house value plus the land value plus the accessory structures, and we get to a total valuation for the property. This is a cost approach to value. It's a modified cost approach. We can look at the sales comparison approach or income approach and then make refinements back into the appraisal, so we can take some of those factors into account. Our default is a cost approach. So briefly, the differences with the commercial schedule is predominantly the variety of properties you have to take into account. So you still start out by finding your base rates, but commercial has 82 structure types. They have four construction types and three level categories that apply back to those 82 types. So there's 984 distinct base rate combinations. And the issue is that I cannot appraise a bowling alley based on a grocery store. Commercial is so distinct. If you're not on the same type of property with the same construction, it's apples and oranges. So it's a much larger schedule. They have general adjustments, just as the residential does. This includes the area to perimeter ratio, the wall height adjustment, the use type adjustment, adjustments for quality, age and condition, physical, functional, and economic obsolescence, and percentage of completion. Just like the residential, there are component adjustments. And the commercial schedule components are things such as exterior wall, air conditioning system, heating system, plumbing, sprinkler system, escalators, and elevators. And we need to further adjust for the secondary areas of the improvement. Porches, canopies, shelters, patios and decks, docks and garages, utility rooms, cold storage areas. And each of these attachments has its own base rate, size adjustment, et cetera. Now, commercially, we need to value the land either as square foot, acre basis, or unit basis. We can value it as commercial, industrial, exempt, or other. And we assess typically either a primary building site, secondary site, apartment building site, communication tower site, undeveloped or residual. So there's 22 available land codes for commercial properties. Again, there's just a much wider variety because we have to fit the exact model of what's being built.
Is industrial considered commercial?
Mm-hmm. It's lumped in with commercial, but it is second. In fact, our senior appraiser is classified as a commercial / industrial appraiser because it does work a little bit differently. Land value for commercial, again, is adjusted for site preparation, topography and floodplain, shape and size, deed restrictions, economic misimprovement, corner or alley influence, view influence, easements, associated parcels. And they also have to value the accessory structures such as paving and parking, fencing and lighting, canopies and shelters, utility buildings, storage buildings, garages, bleachers, courts and pools, bathroom, restroom structures, campsites, mobile home, RV park spaces, golf course sites, cemetery sites. We value grave sites. I did not know that before I worked for the tax department. I have been educated. The formula is basically the same for them, but they're going to take the primary structure plus the land plus the accessory structures. This brings them to a total valuation. Any questions about the basic flow that we're looking at with that?
I got a question. Oh, go ahead. You know, you go. You start. I got a question on the commercial thing.
Sure.
When you go, say, if you go to appraise a strip mall,
mm-hmm.
and this strip mall's doing wonderful, and it's mm-hmm. totally full of tenants,
sure.
and really, you know, doing great.
Mm-hmm.
And you go to another strip mall, and that's half empty because most of them have moved to a different place. That's got to impact the value when you do it, right? I mean, the structure doesn't matter and all this other stuff. It's the value of the property now, right?
You have to differentiate out two different factors. And one is the quality of management, and one is the influence of the location or general market conditions.
Mm-hmm.
If the reason that the occupancy level is low and perhaps the rental level has had to go down to attract occupants is that the market has shifted, say everybody's gone from one side of town to the new shopping center on the other side of town, then that's going to affect the property, no matter how it's managed. That's going to affect the rent, the lease income to that property. If the issue is poor management, which can also be a reason the occupancy levels are low, also be a reason why the income levels are low, I can't adjust for poor management. So in the scenario that you're giving, I think that you would have a disparity of incomes due to a market factor we can adjust for if we need to. What we get into, though, is if you look at incomes, you're looking for an average, you're looking for a typical or market rate, and within that market rate, you're going to have folks that are above and folks that are below. The folks that are above will not appeal, will not show you their income. The folks that are below will. So we're always asking the question, is your income low because you're just on the low end of the spectrum, you're not able to get to median, or is your income low because they've all gone to Tanger Outlets or they've all gone to Alamance Crossing and you're left holding the bag?
Yeah, so I was kind of thinking about things. The Sears situation. Once that, say they pull out of
exactly.
Holly Hill,
yep.
that impacts the value of Holly Hill, doesn't it?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, that's as you begin to see migrations out. Now, if they can put back a similar tenant,
right.
they're fine. But if that's a sign that there's a problem there, that just are no longer as valuable to lease that mall space, well, there you go. Now, the issue becomes one of the date of appraisal. So if that's demonstrated, say, 4 years from now, you know what? We just can't get anybody back in here. Well, then I have to ask the question, is that something that's happened in those 4 years, or was that there January 1st of 2017? Because our schedule is basing off of January 1st of 17. I can't update to changes in market condition in the interim. So that's the challenging point. And there's many appeals and many appraisals that go on to discuss that issue, to say that, well, the market was there, the market problem was there during January 1st of 2017. We just haven't been able to prove it until 4 years later, you know.
Jeremy, the big issue with respect for our last revaluation was we had the valuations done up front when the market was high, and then mm-hmm. in 2008, when the bottom fell out, we were still
basing it on the
what we did
numbers,
in the previous
yeah.
year.
Exactly. Well, and that's the difficulty with building a schedule, with conducting mass appraisal. I'm an Olympics fan. I'm not a sports person generally, but I love to watch the Olympics. And in the Winter Olympics, they have this thing called curling. I don't know if you're aware of Olympic curling. I thought it was going to be a bodybuilding thing, curling a ball
activity.
Or something. They're throwing a stone, or they're sliding a stone on the ice, and they've got a team that skates out in front of it and sweeps the ice, and they can make that stone curve this way or curve that way.
They control that one.
Mm-hmm. I think they blow on it.
Look, this is my stone right here.
Yeah.
I am throwing that down the ice, but I don't know what's going to happen by January 1st. And the only thing I have to tell me about January 1st are sales that have occurred in the past. And to get a statistically significant number of sales, I don't mean last week. I mean the last couple of years trended forward. So I'm always taking a little bit of a guess. Where will the market be when we call it? Now, what the appraisal staff does is they get those brooms out and they run out ahead, and all the way down to the time we send notices, they're sweeping furiously trying to curb it towards that final point. Last time we got caught with the stone going way over here, and the appraisers could not curve it back.
They had too heavy a book to carry.
That was the problem. So, Jeremy, can I ask, this sure. isn't part of your presentation, but when it comes to economic incentives, it kind of is relevant. How do you appraise the equipment that goes into the industry?
That's the easiest part in the world.
Is it book value?
It's book value.
It's just book value. Just look at accounting records.
In the state of North Carolina, the way that this is performed is that personal property, they tell us what they paid for it. We use a state-issued depreciation scale on what they paid for historically, and that is the number.
So it's not paid. So they could have an accelerated depreciation schedule, but that's not going to count. You're going to use a state depreciation schedule.
Right. We do have the ability to make some adjustments. We're not legally bound to follow the state. If we wanted to, for example, build our own in-house, we could do that. We don't have the expertise to do that. I'd much prefer to defer back to the DOR. We can and have on appeal. Sometimes we've seen some problems. We've had to make some adjustments.
Okay. Well, they'll have a cap value for the company will have a cap value for that equipment, right, that they use for tax purposes.
Cap,
right?
The capital.
Yeah, but what they report to us is the initial acquisition cost. So even if they're buying used equipment, I don't want to know what they paid for it used. I want to know what was it brand new and how old is it. And then we're going to apply
that. And you adjust that rate off of that.
Which means that we lose value every year until we get down to a residual, usually around a quarter. I mean, that varies by type. When we see them come in, there's this surge of personal property and then the slow decline down until they hit equilibrium because they're bringing equipment offline, replacing it with new equipment on a routine basis. And so there's this spike and leveling out. A few special considerations that I wanted to bring up, and I don't want to keep us here too long, but I think they're worth mentioning. One is comparison to 2009. So what's the bottom line difference between the 17 schedule and the 09 schedule? The answer on the bottom line is not much. Right? The overall valuation levels are pretty similar now to what they were for the 2009 revaluation. This is what the market has done. Basically, we were on a continual climb, and the first circle represents where we locked in for the 09 schedule. And then we slid to the bottom, and we were on the bottom for a few years. We started climbing back out. The second circle is where we're at now. As you can see, all we've done is come back to the starting point. Some of the very preliminary comparisons, we're running about 103% of what we had last year. But the 3% would include growth from new construction between years. So basically, we're roughly flat between the 09 schedule and the 17 schedule. That does not mean they're the same. The overall valuation may be equivalent, but they're not the same. I have made up a little chart here. Uh-oh.
Is that your phone?
Not me.
It's not me. I don't have a phone.
It shouldn't be mine. Mine's turned off.
I got a mystery dinger up.
What we've tried to do with the 2017 schedule is correct a lot of the inconsistencies of the 2009 schedules. Speaking as someone who has been an appraiser, that this was a problem I had to deal with when everything happened back in 09. One of the most frustrating parts as an appraiser is when your schedule is moving around on you. It will not be consistent in the type of valuation of the forms. And in order to make it work, in order to approximate market, you're constantly pulling and pushing against your schedule trying to get there. The 17 does not have this problem. The 17 is extremely consistent. This means that in places where the 09 schedule had overvalued properties, these owners are going to see reductions. They were too high, they're coming down. Now, a lot of these have already been fixed on appeal, but there's still some out there we come across routinely. The other side of the equation, however, is that owners that were too low before and did not mention it, I wouldn't, will suddenly be raised up on par with everyone else. And I think what you're going to see are a number of appeals coming off of that group right there, where the 09 schedule had undervalued them and we're now getting them up to market. There's nothing to be done for an increase between the two unless we can relate it back to market values. If they can show that the property is not worth what we have on it, we'll fix it. If the only problem is that they've been too low for 8 years, congratulations, you were too low for 8 years, but we have to get you caught up at this point. The other thing I want to point out is that the market is imperfect. So our schedule of values is completely consistent. It will value the same property the same way every time. It's just a mechanical mathematical process. However, if you chart sales, there's a scatter plot, those sales are never consistent. Anyone that's worked with scatter plots before, you know exactly what I'm talking about, because you'll have data points. Why is this one higher than that one? They're at the same location on the x-axis. Why is this one higher? Why is it? I don't know. I can see a trend. I can see basically a curve forming through here. Right? Different buyers and sellers have different opinions of value and different abilities to negotiate the price. Some people get a deal. Some people get stuck. When we build a schedule of values, we shoot for the middle. We try to trend it through what a typical selling price is. Problem is now, for the ones that sold above our curve, they're pretty happy. We came in a little bit less than what they paid for it, and for the most part, they're okay with that. The ones that sold down below the curve here, well, they're not so happy because they know that we have them for more than they paid for their property. Matter of fact, I bet this person is going to appeal. They have a pretty substantial gap between them and the curve. Well, the problem is that we're being consistent, the market isn't being consistent. And I can't catch up these low ones any more than I can catch up the high ones. Just because you paid more, I'm not going to chase you up to your sale. And just because you paid less, I'm not going to chase you down to your sale. I'm looking for the median, normal, typical valuation. But be prepared that some of the appeals are going to come from this phenomenon. Just a quick review of our schedule. This is today. I'm presenting the schedule to the board as required by statute. We're also going to place a copy on the website so that anybody can download it, look at it themselves. We're going to place a copy in the map room downstairs. Anybody can come look at the hard copy. I really value input from our citizens. We've gone the transparent route. We haven't gone hiding what we're doing route. The one courtesy that I would request is that recognize that there are so many interconnected adjustments that one individual rate or one individual type taken by itself, you could come out with all kinds of different values for it. You have to think about it holistically. It may be that you could set a higher or lower base rate, but then your adjustments downstream bring it back to the same point at the end of the day. Please bear in mind this is a system. The other thing is, I would love to hear the input before the next meeting of the board. If I hear it in a public hearing, I have very little ability to quickly respond to that. If I know about it in advance, I can research it, we can talk, we can be informed and make informed statements. Those are the only things that I would ask of the public as they examine the schedule.
Jeremy, I tried going to that website over the weekend. Mm-hmm. And I got to the website, but I couldn't find any link to the schedule. It's not there yet.
That's it. It'll be posted after the meeting.
All right.
After we agree to have
August. It. All right.
So from here, we put those out. We do need to approve a public hearing for the next meeting. We wanted to pick an evening meeting so we can get as many folks as possible if they want to come in and discuss. So we'll be advertising that if the board will approve to have the public hearing. Then after that, there is the adoption, hopefully, of the schedule on November 7th.
So it cannot be approved at hearing. We'd have to have a waiting period after before it can be adopted. And even after adoption, there's an appeal period. They can appeal to the Park Tax Commission in Raleigh if they're concerned, all the way out to December 7th. Coming around to February, we're going to send out our new notices, our notices of new values. Owners will be able to file informal appeals online, by mail, by phone, or in person. We're expecting up to 10,000 appeals. We had 16,000 last time. We're thinking that's going to be less. Really, our goal would be something around 7,000, which is 10%. But I think because of some of the problems between the two schedules, we're going to see an elevated amount. So we're prepared for 10,000 appeals. If we get 10,000 appeals, then I would expect to see about 1,500 of those carry forward to the Board of Equalization. About 300 of those would actually appear before that board. The others would probably be settled on the way to the board. Planning to start that in May of 2017. They can handle a maximum of 100 appeals a month. That pushes their capacity to do that many. So that's about 3 months worth of hearings. After the board concludes then in July, we're probably looking at 15 appeals, if we're average, going to the Park Tax Commission in Raleigh. And Clyde Albright and I will carry on and hear those.
That is something to look for.
Yes, can't wait, can you?
Very excited. I don't know if anyone has seen Clyde in action in any court process. He will fool you because he's a nice guy, but he is a very talented legal representative. So.
Thank you. I think.
This does raise questions about the budget, because obviously we're going to still be under appeal while the budget is being set. And this is going to be an estimate situation. As we go through with each number we add, we're going to be reporting back, so that you have the best estimate for setting the budget. Again, at this early juncture, it will be very level. I mean, I don't know exactly where we'll end up, but just letting you know. That's it. Are there any questions?
How many parcels?
70,000 parcels.
That's a lot of visiting.
Yes. Well, and we had great success. Let me tell you, we contacted our local realtors and actually even got into everything from surveyors to contract construction people to appraisers, getting out there, visiting properties for us. If we hadn't had that, I don't know how we would have gotten our data collection in. There's no way that the staff we have can run all of that. And so we were very much in the debt of the folks that went out and did the legwork for us.
I got a couple questions.
Sure.
Number one, how many commercial appeals do we have during the last one?
I don't know the number of commercial appeals. Any idea?
No.
Not sure. I can find that out.
Okay. And secondly, being on the board the last time we did the mailing of the notices,
yes.
I know you and I had talked about it, and Frank had talked about getting out to the public mm-hmm. to make them aware of how the revals are truly done
right.
up front, so they understand when they get the bill
right.
how it got there and where it is and why it's like it is. Where are we in those efforts?
We are actually beginning to gear up for that. The original plan was to do it over the summer, and in talking with Frank and the Board of Equalization, one of the concerns that was brought to our attention is that there's very low attendance if you do it in the summer, for one.
Right.
About the time the school is out and about the time the time's changing and folks are out in their yards, attendance drops significantly. The other thing is that it's not real to most people until they see the bill. Now, I don't want to wait until that point, but I'm hoping that if we get closer to time, it will be more real, it will be more present, we'll get more attendance. This past week, I was actually at a class out in Durham. About 50% of the attendees were assessors like myself, and I threw that out there to them. What did they do? And I got the same feedback that if you hold town hall meetings early in the year, no one will show up. If you wait till right at time, everyone will show up because it
yeah.
becomes present and concerning. So that's what we've planned to
well,
do.
Well, and I think that is good to have transparency in this process. Mm-hmm. And number you know, you guys did the work. I mean, we didn't hire it out to an outside firm, which got us in trouble the last time. We based all our decisions at budget time on what we thought was a good evaluation, and it wasn't, and we've paid since. But anyhow, I hope that we can get in front of this and educate the public about it. And
well, everything is being done on the up and up, and that begins at the top. I appreciate this board for your commitment and your integrity. One of the things I've heard from my peers is, you know, is your board pushing for you to get some more tax base in there? Absolutely not. And that says something to me about your characters, and I appreciate that. I want to do a professional job. I don't want to be pushed to go high, to go low, or anything in the middle, but just place it as accurately and as equitably as possible. And this board has supported that, and I thank you. And I hope the public realizes that that's our only goal. I have no other agenda but to try to get your value as close to market as possible. And I want their feedback. Commissioner Byrd, I can't get into all the houses. When the citizen contacts me, it's gold to me. It's a chance for me to get my records right. So I welcome any of our citizens that want to raise their hand and say, well, I have a concern, can you come look at it? Because we want to get this right.
And I've got a Jeopardy question. How many out of everybody that comes in your office having a complaint, how many said, I cannot sell my house for this amount of money?
The vast majority.
Okay.
I'll say 80 to 90%.
Yeah. I know. And that's where the education comes in, because you're not truly basing it on sales. You're basing it on what the whole county looks like.
But we still should, with a reevaluation. This is your chance. At a reevaluation, if you can tell me that you couldn't sell it for that, I can fix it. Yeah. A couple of years from now, you might be out of luck. This is the chance.
And then you got the guy that decides to sell, and he says, would you come reevaluate and jack that price up so I can get more fun?
Well, there is a small group every year that asks for us to increase the Axie Appeal, wanting more
right
valuation.
Because as a realtor, people look at that,
absolutely,
too. When you put it on MLS, they say tax value 200, mm-hmm, and I'm asking 240. They're going to say, well, why do you want 40 more than they, mm-hmm, thought it was worth?
At the last revaluation, we had one individual come in informally, asked for an increase, received an increase, came formally to the Board of Equalization, asked for a further increase, received a further increase, and was talking about maybe needing to go down to Raleigh because we didn't get it high enough. That's the one time I've seen that happen.
Well, he was getting ready to put it on the market. You can bet on that.
Right, exactly.
All right. I guess our duty today is to put the hearing on the next meeting.
We have a public hearing.
Public hearing for October. Next meeting, October 2nd. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, very good. Thank you, Jeremy, for your hard work.
Mr. Chairman, I do want to say thanks to Jeremy and his staff on this, and they've really been geared up for it. We've had additional appraisers on. We've put money to the appraisal budget. It's been this board's commitment to bring it back in-house as well to make sure it's done right.
Actually, how was our cost savings by doing so?
That is a cost. I don't know. We paid them over $1 million for the last consultant.
The last time was $1.6 million
right
total cost of the project. We're coming in under $1 million at this point.
Right.
So we're already ahead on our appraisal. So, good.
but again, how important this is, and as Mr. Chairman, you remember, when we set the tax rate 8 years ago, we set it at 52 cents, and that was thinking we were having 5% worth of appeals coming in. And it ended up being about 12%. And instead of a 52 cent revenue neutral, it was really 54.5 cents.
Right.
So that was about a $3 million, almost $3.5 million shortfall, even from revenue neutral. So a lot of communities do a 4-year revaluation cycle. We have chosen to do an 8-year. And I think that's one of the other things the public needs to realize, is we are looking back what it was 8 years ago compared to what it is now. So that, you know, if there is a change, remember, a lot of places property values have increased over the last 8 years. Maybe not a lot, but they have increased.
Cost of building has increased too, I promise.
Yes, sir. but again, Jeremy has done just an incredible job, and I want to thank him and his staff for the work that they do.
Very good. Thank you, Jeremy. All right, next we have a budget amendment for performance bonus.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will do that. If the board is aware, when we did our performance-based savings for the 14-15 fiscal year, we had a savings that we allocated to appropriated fund balance of $1.182 million. And if the board also remembers, we took approximately a $500,000 from that to balance off this fiscal year. And that left us a balance of $781,000. And what we would like to do is recommend to the board that for the 14-15 bonuses for our for those departments that met their goals under performance-based budgeting, we would do a $500 bonus for those employees, and that is $343,937.01. And that will leave a balance for the 14-15 performance base of $338,846. And we usually do this, remember, as we discussed at our last meeting, usually do it in December or right after Thanksgiving. However, with the election coming up, and I think Kathy said we have over 300 poll workers trying to do an extra check for performance-based expenditure of poll workers, it really was a huge burden on our payroll department. So okay, we would like to request that these funds be allocated at this time.
And the funds were coming, it was something funny about that, I was just trying to pull it up, coming out of the bond performance.
I'm sorry, that information should have been updated, commissioners. Where this money is actually coming from is the performance-based budgeting.
Okay, it was something to do with the school and that statement. I'm thinking that, how's that working?
Okay. I'm glad you said that.
Right.
I was wondering about that.
Yeah.
They were encumbered funds.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So this is all consistent with the policy that's put in place?
Those, not all departments met their goals, so not all departments are receiving the $500 bonus.
And the money's already been appropriated.
Yes, sir. Into that performance. Yeah.
Right. The money is sitting currently in the fund balance for the performance management program. So with this budget amendment, it'll allow us to budget for the expense and reduce our fund balance.
Okay. So it's just kind of moving it from one
line to the other.
Out, so
all right.
I'll move that.
Thank you, Bob.
Sir.
Thank you, Roger. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
All right. Very good. Soil and water, Brad, I think you must be next. Look good in that tie today.
Thank you. I come before you today to ask for an approval of a multi-species cover crop grant. This grant has been awarded to the Soil and Water Conservation District, and it's from the North Carolina Foundation for Soil and Water Conservation. This grant is for a demonstration site here in our county to establish, to show producers that a diverse mixture of cover crop species can be planted in a timely manner, allowed to grow and accumulate biomass and nitrogen, and to be terminated without tillage. Basically, some of the particulars about the grant, it's a small grant of $5,500. There's no match required on the county. Is it a reimbursement type grant? The funding or this grant would be used in 2016 and 2017, and it actually would end in 2018. The cover crop is the $5,500 is broken down. There's a portion of the money to be used for the actual purchase of the seed and for the demonstration plot. And the demonstration plot, our particular plot, would be around 13 acres. Half of that would be this multi-species cover crop, and then there'll be a single species cover crop, and it'll be in strips. Some of that funding would also be used to host field days and workshop, having the meeting, a meal, and so forth. And then there is a management fee that would be coming to the county. $2,000 of the $5,500 would be coming to the county for administering that project.
There's no, we don't have to contribute to this, so.
Correct.
Any questions about it? I make a motion that we approve.
Second.
Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Rainey, it's good to have you with us this morning.
Thank you.
I know you work hard over there with that soil and water stuff.
Appreciate it.
All right, budget amendment from finance.
We forgot.
Oh.
Social services.
Social service. I'm sorry, I just ran right on over you, didn't I?
Yeah, it's okay. So you have a budget amendment from the Department of Social Services in front of you today. It's a grant that was received by the Family Justice Center, and Cindy Brady's here that can answer any questions you have. We have several grants that you're going to be seeing before us, so we decided to go with the format that we put before you, a fact sheet that kind of explains the grant period, the partners, the target population, the impact on the county in terms of personnel, whether there's a match, what our goals are in the grant, and then what our projected outcomes are, because I think that's really important when we talk about bringing money in. What is it going to do for our citizens? So this elder justice grant is $350,000. You have a budget amendment for the first year of this. This is a three-year grant with primary partners of the district attorney's office, the Elon Police Department, Adult Protective Services at DSS, and the Family Justice Center as the lead organization. You can see the goals, the outcomes that we're hoping to accomplish are increased reporting. It's a big training grant. We hope to train folks in how to identify elder abuse and what to do. And does have a direct service component in years 2 and 3. And Cindy's here. She can answer any questions that you have about how this will be implemented in Alamance County over the next 3 years. It will be a separate allocation line for as a part of social services through our finance department. So you'll be able to track that in our budget going forward.
Y'all have any questions?
I don't have any questions, though. Okay. I move we approve.
Good. Right. Second.
Thank you, Roger. That's
all
so
right.
Easy.
Thank you for mentioning our stuff now.
I wasn't going to do it under commissioner's report,
that's fine.
But we can do it now while Susan's standing up here because we were successful in getting this $250,000 grant
mm-hmm.
from the Bureau of Justice Assistance,
that's
which
correct.
Is part of the Department of Justice. Yeah. And we learned about this grant opportunity when we did our when we attended the Stepping Up Summit in April. And so Susan was really the primary author of the grant. She had a lot of help.
The author.
But it was a team effort, really. But Susan, why don't you go ahead and explain what we're going to do with this.
So we're excited. So this is kind of our first step in implementing our initiatives from the resolution you passed about how to impact the mentally ill in the jail. Big partner is our this will actually be a county grant, and the Sheriff's Department will be taking the lead on this grant. So this focus will be around training our officers in crisis intervention training. And if you as we all know what's been happening in our country, and repeatedly with the shootings and the things that are happening, you hear folks talking about our law enforcement need training. And Chief Deputy Britt's here, and he is 100% endorsing that 100% of the Sheriff Department's patrol officers are CIT trained. It gives them another tool in their tool belt. The focus of this will be to CIT train all of our officers for all departments, not just Sheriff's Department, but to get that moving in that direction.
All local law enforcement.
Right. And so the grant has a piece that will pay overtime to help get that, make that happen. Then there's a co-responders program that Chief Deputy Britt's awfully excited about. It will partner a licensed clinical social worker in the field with an officer on mental health calls.
That's good.
As an effort to provide a different kind of intervention and hopefully be able to decrease the amount of time the officer's on site with that kind of situation. This will fund a coordinator for this effort as well. That will be part of our county staff, and then also fund training on mental health first aid for other first responders in our community like CCOM and EMS, and Craig's working on that initiative. So that's exciting. We also have a $300,000 three-year grant to provide prevention services at social services, and then Cindy Brady has another
Governor's Crime Commission grant that you'll be hearing about. So when you total all that, we're well over $1 million in grant funding this cycle.
And we have two other grants applications in process with the Governor's Crime Commission and the Governor's Office.
Yes, we do, for the Stepping Up Initiative to fund the Diversion Center.
Crossed on
the... So it's an exciting time.
It is exciting, and thank you for all your work, and Chief Deputy Britt, Craig, Bob.
That's for sure. I can't not thank Impact Alamance. They funded the grant writer for Stepping Up. They funded the grant writer for the Elder Abuse Grant. And they funded the grant writer for the Community Response Prevention Grant that Adrian will be overseeing provides prevention.
Good.
So we wouldn't have been able to do it without that kind of coordinated community.
It's a good time to be in Alamance County.
Yes, it is.
Sure.
And I can't wait for my first disc golf.
That's right. Thank you, Susan. All right. Craig, I guess you...
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. You have a budget amendment in front of you with respect to $19,483.58. That is an additional cost that have been associated with putting in the road over at the North Carolina Commerce Park. That is our third share. Hopefully we're wrapping
up. This is an overrun of that,
yes,
right,
sir.
On what we anticipated.
Yes, sir. Hopefully we made a budget amendment last month, but some additional bills came in. So this is equally shared between MEV and Graham.
I move approval.
All right. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Roger. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. And last, we have the county manager report. Have you got something wonderful to tell us?
A couple of things I do want to mention. One, I do want to thank, is Debbie still here? I want to thank Debbie Hatfield, who's our emergency management coordinator, and also Johnny Payne for the work they did on Tangle Ridge Trail. That was really, it's a private drive. And Debbie and Johnny and coordinated helping get those residents a temporary bridge. They were out there for two straight days coordinating with the state, coordinating with the property owners, coordinating with the Forestry Service. Just a true definition of really what Alamance County, one of our number one priorities is emergency management and public safety. So I did want to thank Debbie and
Johnny
as well.
It was basically all him. We were dealing with a fuel spill. Jesse was handling with Matt also, and Matt really helped her out. And we worked together on this end.
But it truly was, and I thank staff, but we really stepped up, and I'm very proud of the work that they've done, and very proud to be part of this staff. The other thing I do want to mention is we had our SOAR Award breakfast last Friday, and we had 9 nominees, and want to announce that our winner was Shaniqua Pryor. And Shaniqua, if you want to stand up, and I will read your winning nomination. Just want to send you an email regarding our social worker, Shaniqua Pryor. It's been a short time that we've been working together since March. In that short time, numerous ordeals have occurred, requiring my wife and I to work closely with Ms. Shaniqua to find resolutions. Ms. Shaniqua has been great, just to name a few things. We are having difficulty obtaining replacement medication. Not only did Ms. Shaniqua call the provider, she did follow up calls and kept us abreast of where things were in the process, so we didn't think we had to be left by the wayside. Also, when we notified Ms. Shaniqua that one of the children did not have a mattress, she found one for the child and made arrangements to have it delivered the same day. These are just a few examples of Ms. Shaniqua has been supportive in assisting with the children's very unique needs, and not only met our expectations, she has exceeded them. She has been excellent to work with thus far, and we are looking forward to continue to work with her. It can be so easy to report the negatives that we all sometimes forget to report the positives. The Key family really appreciates working with you, Ms. Shaniqua. So we do want to thank you for... We have a plaque and gifts and all that we will get to you, but we did want to publicly recognize you here today. So do you want to say anything?
No, I'd just like to say thank you, and it's an honor to receive this
Thank you, Shaniqua. Very nice.
I do want to read one other one that we had at our meeting, and this is for Wanda Johnson, and this really is not just a quarter. This has been a multi-year process for this social service worker, and I did want to read this to you. I'm sending this much overdue appreciation for one of your employees. Her name is Wanda Johnson, and she is not aware of this, but she actually saved my life. Currently, my children and I are in a program that Ms. Johnson recommended. Someone told me about family abuse, so I went there thinking that maybe they could give me money. In my mind, I thought if I could just get enough money to get enough drugs, then maybe I would just die and I would have no worries. Because I knew I could not take care of myself or my children, I had no desire to go on. I'm sure it was obvious I needed help with my bruises and no sleep, and my clothing, yes, I slept in them. Ms. Johnson did not stare at my appearance, but went on to tell me that it was lunchtime and that she would get me food. She went on to say that if I'd like to apply for any type of assistance, and she named off things, but I heard the word cash assistance, thinking she would be giving me money, and that's all that I really wanted. I really needed something to take the edge off. I broke down that day and told her everything from well, there's a lot of things I don't think I should read. I even shared my drug and alcohol problems. Ms. Johnson told me if I truly wanted help, that she knew of a place that I could go and take my children if this is what I wanted. In my mind, I wasn't sure if I was going. She told me my children needed me no matter what, and she had faith in me that I was going to make it. She told me it wouldn't be easy. Ms. Johnson asked me if she could call me to check on me and my children. Ms. Johnson did call later in the day and the following morning to see if I was still going to treatment. This was almost 2 years ago. I stayed in the facility that Ms. Johnson called, and now I have a place of my own. I am going to school and working on all of the programs. She took an extra minute to just listen and care. I never had a good relationship with my mother or always dreamed or had visions of what a real mother is, and I believe Ms. Johnson is that vision. Ms. Johnson acted out of instinct, not for the glory, and to this day, I believe she saved me from myself. My children are thriving, and so am I. Please let Ms. Johnson know that she made a difference. One day, I hope to come back to Alamance County and introduce my children to Ms. Johnson. So, really wanted the impact that we do make on a daily basis from all departments, if it is covering up a pothole so people can have emergency care, or if it's doing programs, we really do provide public service. And again, very proud to work for this community and work with this staff. So, that's all I have.
Any commissioner comments?
Yeah, I wanted to report on a couple of things. Mm-hmm. First off, in addition to getting this grant announcement for stepping up, we had a very successful day on September the 20th, the day after our last meeting, where we had, 85 people get together from around the community. A lot of county people were represented there, but it was a community dialogue. It was a whole day event to really examine this issue of mental illness in our jails and coming up with strategies to do something about it. So we had our DA there and assistant DA and sheriff was there and Chief Deputy Britt was there and Zach Fisher and Stacy, part of our leadership group. Susan, Adrian, were you there? Yeah, Adrian was there. I mean, a lot of people. And Craig, Craig, our county manager, was there.
He didn't bring biscuits, I promise.
But no, it was a very successful day, and boy, I tell you, the energy is really flowing in this project. And the other thing I wanted to report on is that I represent District 11, which is a six-county area in the Triad, on the Board of Directors for the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners. And last week, I'm actually filling in the last year of Dan Engel's term. and was on that board before he resigned. And so I had my first board meeting with that association in Washington, D.C. This is the first time that that board of directors had ever met outside of North Carolina. And so last Tuesday, we traveled by bus to D.C., and we came back Thursday night. But while we were there, on the way to checking into our hotel, we stopped and had a tour of C-SPAN. If you've never toured C-SPAN, if you ever have the opportunity, please do. I think we got the tour because the executive director of the association used to work at C-SPAN. So very enlightening. But just to be on that bus and networking with 35 other commissioners from around the state was very valuable. But after our meeting, we were hosted by Senator Tom Tillis. And he had a two-day or two-half-day, like an institute planned for us. And we learned a lot and learned about his ability to help counties do a lot of things. For example, there are federal programs that are helping to get broadband in all the rural places in this country. And so we had two of our speakers. One represented the FCC, and one represented the... let me see if I can find it. You wouldn't have thought that this agency would have anything to do with broadband, but it's the Undersecretary for Rural Development of the U.S. Department of Agriculture. And so I put Bruce Walker and gave him some information to look into about helping maybe to get some broadband services in our rural parts of the community. But we had a speaker on a couple of speakers on mental health and public safety. One was a psychiatrist from the American Enterprise Institute. One was a woman from the Treatment Advocacy Center. Very, very informative. But just to know that Senator Tillis's office is there for us. And, you know, there's a lot of importance in having state government, federal government, and county government working together. And there's a lot of opportunities to do good for our communities. And so this association... that's what that's all about, is representing our local counties to both state and the federal government. So, very worthwhile trip.
Roger. I just want to make a quick comment, Craig, to what you said. It's good to be up here and represent a county where the employees come to work every day and don't just look at it as a job. And that's how we help people. And I appreciate each and every one that are here today and the all our employees that do that. I think that's just something in our mission as a county to go over and beyond to help others. So thank you. And with that, any other comments? We'll adjourn.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's public access channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.